What up, guys? Welcome back to my room. I am gonna do a let's play the beginner's guide. I heard a lot of good reviews on Steam, so let's go ahead and jump into it and start playing. You know, let's see what this game's about. Let me turn it up a little bit. Please make sure your audio is on. Audio is on. Controls. All right. A blank screen.
Hi there. Thank you very much for playing the Beginner's Guide. My name is Davey Reedon. I wrote The Stanley Parable. Cool. And while that game tells a pretty absurd story, today I'm going to tell you about a series of events that happened between 2008 and 2011. We're going to look at the games made by a friend of mine named Coda. Now, these games mean a lot to me. I met Coda in early 2009 at a time when I was really struggling with some personal stuff, and his work pointed me in a very powerful direction. I found it to be a good reference point for the kinds of creative works that I wanted to make. Cool. So just to start you off, this is, I think, the first game he ever made. It's a level for Counter-Strike. You can walk around here, by the way. And mostly it's just Coda learning the basics of building a 3D environment. But what I like is that even though he starts from the simple aesthetic of a desert town, he then scatters these colorful abstract blobs and impossible floating crates around the level. And of course, it destroys the illusion that this actually is a desert town, and instead this level becomes a kind of calling card from its creator. It's like a reminder that this video game was constructed by a real person. And it kind of makes you wonder, what was going through his head as he was building this? This is what I like about all of Coda's games. I mean, not that they're all fascinating as games, but that they are all going to give us access to their creator.
I want us
to see past the games themselves. I want to get to know who this human being really is. And that's exactly what we're going to do here.
Cool.
So, it's 2008, Coda starts making these games, and he never releases any of them. He doesn't put them onto the internet, he just makes them and then immediately abandons them, and they sit on his computer forever. And I think he really understood this image of himself as a recluse. At one point, he jokingly renamed his computer's recycling bin to Important Games Folder. So, you know, this was just how he worked. He tended to crank them out one after the other without even really pausing to try to understand what he had just made, until suddenly one day, he just stopped.
Wow.
In 2011, that was it. He made his last game, and then he hasn't made another one since. And that's why I've taken this opportunity to gather all of his work together, is because I find his games powerful and interesting, and I'd like this collection to reach him, to maybe encourage him to start creating again. And if the people like you who play this also happen to find his work interesting, then I'm sure it'll just send that much stronger of a message of encouragement to Coda. So thanks for joining me on this. If you have a particular interpretation that I haven't mentioned here, or if you just need to get in touch, you can email me at daveywreden@gmail.com. Okay, that's about it for introduction. Let's take a look at Coda's first proper game. As each game is loading, I'll show you the date that it was completed. This first one was made in November 2008.
November 2008. Cool.
Warning. Was the machine active? Shift to structure
imminent. Okay. This game is called Escape from Whisper, and it's one of the more generic games you'll see from
Coda. Warning. Whisper machine status activated. Evacuate immediately. Okay, just a regular shoot. Just regular shooting. Which side should we go through? Let's go through this side. It looks more... Nope. Let's go through the other side. Let's see. Yeah. Can't open doors. Alright. Yeah, cannot open anything. So we're just gonna run.
Uh-oh. Security hall breached. Hostile alien life form.
It kinda looks like this game was abandoned mid-development. For instance, you have this gun, which you'd think would indicate that there are supposed to be monsters or enemies somewhere.
Yep.
But then clearly there are no enemies anywhere. You can't even reload the gun when you run out of bullets. But ultimately, we don't really know. Maybe Coda thought that actually it was complete the way that it is. And I think that we should talk about his games for what they are, rather than for what they're not.
Oh, that's
I love how you can see the bottom of the universe from this room.
Alright, and that fact, let's go over here and see. Nope, that doesn't open. Alright, let's go back. Let's keep on going. Nope, okay, go over here.
Apparently, this space station has a labyrinth on it. Sure, I don't know. There's really no reason for it that I've ever been able to discern, so in the interest of time, I'm just gonna skip you on past it.
What the hell? Alright.
Okay, this is the part that's interesting. The game has this narrative about the Whisper Machine and how it has to be turned off, and then you get to the engine room.
Duh.
Hey,
beautiful
you there,
night.
In the engine room. You could save us all. That beam is powering the Whisper Machine. We could disrupt it by introducing a great enough heat signature. If you... your body could stop the beam.
What?
It's so much to ask, but for all of our lives, would you do it? Could you give yourself?
For humanity? Sure, why not?
Let me pause here for a second. What you just experienced, stepping into the beam and then dying, is probably what Coda had initially intended when he was developing this level. But when he first compiles and plays it, something goes wrong. There's a bug somewhere. And this is what happens instead.
What the f-
The beam causes you to start floating. And this is an important moment for him. Because yes, this is technically a glitch, but Coda identifies something human about it. Like how small it makes you feel in the face of this larger chaotic system.
Uh-huh.
Or this floating could be the afterlife, a peaceful place, juxtaposed against all of the hysteria that you've just had to traverse. I don't even know. I have no idea what he was thinking, but what's clear is that after making this, something lodges itself in his brain. He wants to do more of these really weird and experimental designs. So he stops work on this and moves on to a stream of tiny little games that go in all sorts of directions. Let's go ahead and take a look at the first game he made after leaving this one behind.
Alrighty. Pretty interesting. I mean, the past was behind her. Well, that board was pretty interesting. Okay,
Yep. In this game, you can only walk backwards.
What? No problem with that. I was born backwards. What the?
So it's a short and relatively minimalist experiment combining motion and narrative. It is less advanced than the previous game, but actually it seems to be more focused, more complete. Coda is trying to give it a unique voice rather than simply basing it on a pre-existing trope.
Why does the future keep changing? I don't know. Let's see. When she stops and looks, it becomes clearer. What did that one say? Let's see. But if the future is always behind her, how will she find the strength to confront it?
It's a short little thought, it says what it wants to say, and then it ends. Didn't need anything more than that. which to me is why it works, because it gets out quick. Okay, next one.
That wasn't bad. Ah, shit. I'm not a fan of spooky games, but let's see what this has to deal with. You are now entering. Ah, shit.
And that's it. Okay, the meaning of this game won't be clear just yet. Please be patient with me for a few more games, and I promise you'll see what makes it interesting. Oftentimes, Coda would put bizarre titles like this one at the start of his games. I wish I'd known him at the time that he was making these early games. He would really only talk to me about his work as he was making it. Once he stopped work on a game, like, that was it. It was dead to him.
Wow.
And I don't agree with that at all, but what are you gonna do?
Big ass stairs. Ah, keep on going.
Once you've been slowed to an absolute crawl, the door at the top of the stairs opens. So why, if Coda's not showing these games to anyone, why bother opening the door at all? Well, to show you, I'm modifying the game here so that when you press the use key on your gamepad, it'll bring you back up to full speed so you can enter the door for yourself.
You walk around talking to people down from pursuing their hopes and dreams. A key in one game unlocks a door in a complete separate game.
A room that's warm and nice and filled with little ideas for games.
A normal game where you have the screen into a mic every 50 seconds to keep.
Coda would often tell me that he didn't mind if people thought of him as cold or distant. He said that he knew that he was actually a vibrant and compassionate person, but that it takes time to really see that. It can be a very slow climb to get there.
Wow. You start a small room until you realize you can just walk through walls. The game is nothing but giant. What? Damn it. I didn't get to finish reading all that. Pretty good, though. Sorry, that was something. Somebody that was outside. They're gone now. Alright, let's see what this has to do with. Let's see. Sorry for that pause, guys. I'm back. Yeah, I had to do something. So, alrighty. Let's see what this one has to do with.
Well, this is new for Coda. It's an actual puzzle. Go ahead and see if you can solve it.
Ah, puzzles. Okay. Alrighty. The door closes.
Don't forget that solution, because we're going to see this puzzle again soon. We're gonna see it a lot.
Pretty interesting, that one.
Pretty interesting.
Alright, let's do, let's go through this one. What does this do? Oh. Looks like an empty art gallery.
So that seems to be it, right? You walk down a corridor, you solve a puzzle, you get to the end. Simple enough. Alright, now I'm going to modify the game again, so that when you press the use key on your gamepad, it'll remove all of the walls from this room.
Oh, shit.
How about that? There was more to it than we had any way of knowing. I actually find it funny that this game comes after the Stairs game, since they essentially convey the opposite idea. So, in the Stairs game, a dull exterior concealed a rich interior. And then, in this level, a dull interior hides this fantastic outer world. Either way, I think that the point is the same, is that most of the time, you don't get to know what you're missing, or even that you're missing anything. That's not your role as a player.
Pretty
so if your role here is not to understand, then what is it?
Ah, no, not this again. You are now exiting.
Aha. So, this, combined with the entering game from earlier, tells us that Coda believes his games are connected somehow. It could even be that the Stairs game and the puzzle game are literally connected in between this and the entering game. There's a bigger picture that all of his games are meant to play a role in, some larger meaning that we won't be able to grasp until we've seen all of them. Mm. And once we have, we can step back and start to understand what exactly that bigger picture is.
Pretty interesting, pretty interesting. March 2009. Man, how many games does this guy make? Pretty interesting, though. The Great and Lovely Descent. Wow.
Let's talk about video game development for a second. Every video game runs on what's called an engine, which determines what the game can and cannot do. So in other words, the engine is a set of tools for game development.
Where you can do, you know, do stuff, make stuff, and all that.
To make all of these games, Coda is using an engine called Source. Like all engines, Source has certain things that it does well, and it has certain things that it does poorly.
Streetwise.
One of the things that it does very well is boxy linear corridors. That's why so many of Coda's games are set in these large, flat, empty rooms, is just because he's working with what the engine does well.
Damn.
The tools available to the creator shape what kinds of creative work they're going to end up making. You might consider paying attention to the architecture in Coda's games, to notice how they seem to stem from an engine that's very good at producing linear, boxy corridors.
That's, I mean, pretty good. I can't make anything like that for right now. I mean, if I try to make something like that, it would take me a long time to make something like that. But yeah, I mean, it is pretty good. He even gets art. Look at that. Look at that. It looks pretty good. Okay. That was open. Let's go into the restroom first. Okay. Nothing unique in the restroom. Just a toilet. Sink. Lights. Okay. Matter of fact, let's close it. I don't like open doors. Let's close that. Uh-oh. Okay, those don't open. Alright, there's stairs. Let's try to go. Matter of fact, let's go on this side. See if that works. Nope. Okay, that door does not open. Press all my buttons. Nope. Oh. Let's continue. Press start. Ear itching. Break time. Just scratch the ear. Sorry. Alright. We got blocks on that side. Triangle, square. Ooh, that looks like steps. Oh, damn. I don't want to fall off. Oh, shit. I guess you're supposed to fall? Wow. Man, they ought to make a movie out of this. It'd be one of those weird movies. Not too weird. Alright, that's cool. Heard something open. Let's see what that was. Heard something open. Oh, I heard gates pretty much. Heard like a heartbeat. Do stuff like that. Alright.
Oh. This prison, funny enough, in Coda's original design, the doors stayed shut for a full hour before letting you go. If you don't mind, I think we're gonna skip that.
Hell yeah, man!
This is something that he and I used to argue about a lot. You know, whether a game ought to actually be playable, whether it means anything if no one can get through it. And I would always defend that, you know, all this work goes into the game, why not make it playable and accessible? And so we just got into heated arguments over it, and there was one time that after one of these conversations, he went home, and a day or two later, he sent me a zip file entitled Playable Games that was full of hundreds of individual games, each of which was just an empty box that you walked around in and nothing else. Believe me, I played every single one of those just to find out if there was like a gag hidden somewhere. But there wasn't.
Gag has a sense of humor though. I think his point is pretty much you're walking into it. You're looking around, it's playable. It probably doesn't have to have so much functionality into it, probably, you know, because all games come in different kinds, right? Pretty good.
It's the puzzle again, with the exact same solution as the last time. There's still no clear indication of what makes this puzzle so special that Coda is going to return to it over and over. But I promise, I'll share with you my interpretation very shortly.
Something have to do with the future was behind her? I'm assuming? Place? Cabinets? Listen, speak.
Here, listen. Coda begins using a kind of dialogue system that he fashioned out of the engine's chat capabilities. Use the buttons on your gamepad to respond.
Listen, listen, listen. Yes, there was a world stamped with witness. Yes, there was an enormous prison I spent hours in. Yes, there was floating colored blocks. You there, did you come from up above? What's up there? B. Yes, there were. That's the world above. You been there? Now this is important. Did you have to get through a puzzle with two doors and switches? I did. That was literally the last thing I did before coming here. Yes, I did. Again, perfect. Now please tell us how you solved it. Tell us the solution. Tell us how to get to the other side. I don't remember. I then and so trust me, you don't want to go over there. I don't remember how I saw them. B. Let's try B. Oh no, but I do. We do. We need to get there. Do you understand? It's mostly important. Prison. That's it? Okay, so they're trying to escape and I'm trying to get out. This way. Same people. Hello, how did you get here? Was there a puzzle? Yes. Do you want to know how to solve it? No, we actually found the blanks. To be far more interesting. Have you seen it? Why would I care about the space between the doors? Actually, now that you mention it, I remember feeling strange as I passed through it. I don't recall a space. Let's try why. Because it does. Don't think too hard about it. You'll see it again. Interesting. Because it does seem weird, the two doors.
And so we make one last descent down to the final floor of the level.
Damn, nature! There's a street. Wow.
It's a lamppost. Okay, I can't tell you quite why, but for some reason, Coda fixates on this lamppost. It's going to appear at the end of every single one of his games from here on out. I'll tell you what I think. I think that up to this point, you know, he's been making really strange and abstract games with no clear purpose, and maybe you can only float around in that headspace for so long. Because now he wants something to hold on to. He wants a reference point. He wants the work to be leading to something. He wants a destination, which is what this lamppost is. It's a destination. We're going to see it in the work as well. His games are just going to become a lot more cohesive, a lot more fully developed, with more of a clear idea behind them. And as we go, that idea will get clearer and clearer and clearer.
Pretty interesting. So is that one game down? We don't know. Loading April 2009. This game is connected to the internet. As you walk around, you can leave notes. All those you see are well. Okie dokie, that actually wraps up for right now, guys. We'll finish this later. Pretty interesting, though. Pretty interesting. I mean, it has good points, I guess. I guess game developer minds are pretty interesting. To the point? I don't know. But this wraps it up. I'll catch you guys in the next video. Don't forget to click the like button if you like this. And don't forget to subscribe. Peace!